In this episode of EFT Tapping Junction, you and I will explore proven ways to build client relationships, beginning with an initial phone conversation with a new client, followed by that first actual session to set the stage for long-term client satisfaction. That's going to help ensure you become a trusted, ongoing partner. Whether you're a licensed therapist with years of counseling experience, or you're a new coach using EFT to help clients achieve personal or professional goals, there are key actions you can take to help ensure your initial session with a new client goes smoothly. That first session will in large part determine whether you enjoy a long-term relationship as a trusted partner or you have a one-and-done client session. Hello and welcome to this episode of EFT Tapping Junction. I am your host, Steve Carter, founder of Stress Solutions LLC and Stress Relief Radio. Thank you for joining me. Who is this show for? If you are using EFT, which of course is short for Emotional Freedom Techniques, if you use thought field therapy, trauma tapping, or other meridian-based tapping methods, this show is for you. By way of brief introduction, over more than four decades, I've helped thousands of people achieve success in every area of life. I hold trainer and practitioner certifications in an array of methods, to include, of course, emotional freedom techniques, thought field therapy, trauma tapping technique, NLP, meditation, and many others. For more information about my work, my background, and what we offer, visit our website at stressreliefradio.com. There's an old saying that goes, well begun is halfway done. When you're working with new clients, this is an important idea to keep in mind. Let's you and I explore a typical new client interaction. Your new client, we'll call her Jenny. Jenny found your website, and yes, if you don't have a website, I encourage you to create one. When Jenny found your website, she read your About Us page, she reviewed your testimonials, she looked at your service offerings, and she has decided to schedule an appointment to help her with issues that she's been grappling with for a long time. She emails you, or she may call you, and she requests a consultation. While some practitioners will schedule an in-person initial consultation, my suggestion is to handle that initial consultation by phone. Why? Because a phone conversation is less threatening to the client, and it offers an opportunity for you and the client to decide if you're a good match, given your expertise and given the client's goals. This initial phone conversation is typically brief, about 15 minutes or so in length. Your objectives in this initial call: first, to begin building rapport. You want to identify the one or two key issues that are most important to the client. You're going to want to discuss your fees and payment options. And of course, you're going to want to answer any questions the client may have. And again, you're personally assessing whether your experience, your skills, are a good match for what the client is looking for. Over the many years that I've worked with clients, I've lost count of the number of clients that, after that initial conversation, I determined that I was not a good match for that client. Depending on the needs of the client, I would refer them to one or more practitioners who I trusted and, in my view, were better matches for those clients. As an example, if someone was a sexual assault survivor, and especially if there were indications that they were dealing with post-traumatic stress disorder, I would always refer them to well-qualified therapists who specialize in those cases. Assuming that initial call goes well, you'll schedule your client's first 3 appointments. If the client tells you he or she would like to schedule 1 appointment only, you can encourage the client to schedule 3 sessions, but assure the client they can cancel the 2nd or 3rd session if they choose to do so up to a day prior to the appointment date. Do review your fees and payment options so the client knows what to expect when he or she arrives. If you're going to work with the client by phone or Zoom, ensure the client understands how to join that initial full session. Follow up with a confirming email or text that includes all of the relevant information you discussed during your initial call. You'll also want to send the client your release form for them to sign and bring to the session, or if you're working by phone or Zoom, to acknowledge and agree to in an email message. We'll assume your session will be in person in a dedicated professional office. If you are seeing clients in your home, ensure there are no distractions such as children, pets, or televisions that can be heard when you are working. If you are just starting out, I suggest conducting sessions by phone or Zoom. If you do not have a professional office or an appropriate dedicated space in your home. Not all sessions, of course, are formal. There will likely be times you're asked to lead someone in an impromptu session, such as during a sporting event, prior to someone delivering a talk, or some other surprise situation. If that does happen and you choose to honor their request, limit the scope of that session to what is immediately needed to help the person navigate through the immediate situation. You can, of course, encourage that individual to be in touch for a formal session if that is appropriate. If your session is in person, greet the client with a warm smile. Lead the client to the area where you'll be conducting the session. If possible, the room should be cozy and free of clutter. Your light level should be moderate, not too dark or not too bright. Chairs should be comfortable but not overstuffed, unless you're also doing hypnosis work. I suggest that you not use reclining seats. Do have a table to one side of the client so they can put down their purse or any other object so their hands can be free. Position the client so he or she can see the door. Sit about 4 feet, give or take, away from the client at a slight off-center angle so that you're not directly in front of the client. You'll want to keep the space open between you and the client, so that means no desk. After thanking the client for coming and completing the initial small talk, ask your client how much they know about EFT. If they know very little, offer a brief explanation. Regardless of the client's knowledge, tell the client you begin each session by tapping for stress. You can lead this initial tapping session with a setup statement such as, "Any and all stress, I choose to release and let it go." As you tap through the points, invite the client to voice the setup statement and any reminder statements by repeating your words. Reminder statements could be letting go of any and all stress. It is safe to let go of any and all stress. Opening the session by tapping together for stress offers several benefits. First, it relaxes the client and it relaxes you. Recall, this is all new territory for your client. They'll likely be nervous. They'll likely be unsure about what to expect. Secondly, tapping together builds rapport. Your energy systems will align, and you will likely be in emotional harmony after your tapping session. It's now time to invite your client to share his or her story and what outcomes they're looking for. Allow the client to talk without interruption. Use active listening and be quietly present for the client. Take notes if you need to. Do maintain eye contact and listen with a gentle calm that signals you care. After the client is finished, ask whatever clarifying questions you need to ask. In your session flow, this could be a good place to take a history, depending on why the client is seeking help and their psychological situation. The time needed to take a history could be relatively brief, or it could take a good part of that first session. While I may not need to share this reminder, I will do so anyway. Gary Craig, the creator of Emotional Freedom Techniques, provided 6 important words of guidance. Don't go where you don't belong. Don't go where you don't belong. If you're a coach, you'll want to leave psychological treatments for, as examples, depression, general anxiety disorder, post-traumatic stress. These, and there are other conditions as well, that should only be treated by licensed therapists who have the appropriate training to deal with those types of psychological conditions. Returning to your session flow, ask the client which issue or situation he or she would like to begin working through. If the client is hesitant or says something like, "I don't know where to start," be quiet. Allow the client's subconscious mind to work for a reasonable amount of time. That could be 10, 20, perhaps 30 seconds. And then you might ask, what does your intuition tell you about what is most important in this moment? Go silent and allow the client's subconscious mind to offer up to the conscious mind of the client an answer to your question. If the client still can't offer a suggested starting point, consider what the client said when he or she began telling you their story. Typically, the most important starting point will be what a client first talks about or what the client said when he or she ended their story. From there, proceed with the session using your counseling and coaching skills to include client-appropriate techniques you learn during your EFT training. One of those key skills is helping the client find the solutions for their own perceived problems. That may mean helping them reframe issues, find and activate resource states, or otherwise tap into their own resilience. Your job is not to force on the client what you believe is needed. Help the client discover and act on their own realizations and their own solutions. As you're approaching the final 10 minutes of your session, review briefly with the client the progress they've made during that session. Use SUDS ratings as evidence for that progress. Ask the client if they have any questions about what was covered during the session, and of course, answer those questions. I often will close sessions with a final EFT round with a setup statement that can go something like, I choose to allow the beneficial work done through this session to flow and grow throughout my mind, body, spirit, and energy system in the hours and days ahead. As you wrap up your session, encourage your client to continue tapping on whatever needs attention in the days ahead. Ask what the client would like to work on during their next session. Remind the client of the date for that next session. Thank the client and congratulate them on their great progress. While much of what we discussed has been focused on in-person sessions, virtually everything here applies to clients you're working with by phone or by Zoom. If you're doing your own self-care work, before diving into solo tapping for your issues, just as I recommended for your clients, tap an initial round for stress. And when you do that, you are going to enjoy greater clarity as you tap on your personal issues. Helping others with EFT is a beautiful, beautiful gift that keeps on giving to those you are helping and to yourself. You truly are doing heaven's work. If you have questions about anything you and I have discussed during this episode, do email me with your questions at cartermethod@gmail.com. If you're not yet following the EFT Tapping Junction podcast, this is a perfect time to do that. When you follow the show, you will never miss an episode. Speaking of episodes, we have 50 previous episodes of the show available for your listening enjoyment. Visit us at stressreliefradio.com and then click on the podcast tab. You'll find this podcast in the list of podcasts. Click on the EFT Tapping Junction podcast link, and you can listen to all of those previous episodes. I'll also have another listening link in the show notes. Until our next visit together, enjoy joyful living one tap at a time, and may you and your loved ones experience blessings in abundance.